Good morning. We welcome you to worship this morning and pray God's blessing upon us as we worship the Lord together. My name is John Gregory, so pleased to serve here at Pastor at First UMC and to help lead in worship along with our choir and Pam and Cindy on the organ and keyboards and our media team up in the booth. As we begin our service, would you take just a moment and register your attendance with us on the green connect cards that should be in your bulletin? Put those in the offering plate later on as that gets passed, and we would welcome your response to that. As we begin our service, I'm going to highlight a couple of announcements for you, but please read all of the announcements. You wouldn't want me to read them all to you, and I don't have that kind of time, but please read both sides of our announcement page. Let me lift up a couple things to you briefly, and one thing that's not in print I want to share briefly, partly because of a special guest who's here. If you have a birthday in November, please join us at the Parsonage this afternoon at 2:30. You see the details in the bulletin there. If you haven't RSVP, just tell me on your way out or swing by the door I'm at the end. But Dinah's will be our third monthly birthday gathering. We had a great time in September and October. Persons with November birthdays, hope you can join us today at 2:30 at the Parsonage, the address printed in the bulletin insert there. Friends, a very special announcement. The Central Methodist University Chorale is going to be singing with us this upcoming Saturday night at 7 p.m. It'll be a great evening of choral music here at a church that appreciates choral music and has the history of having a wonderful choir and wonderful, I'm missing Pam, Miss Pam, a wonderful choir director for decades and decades. As if that's not good enough, the Three Rivers College Choir will be joining the CMU choir for a number or two. Please be with us Saturday night, 7 p.m., but a couple of you have the opportunity to do something really special and host some of the students in your home. Our choir director, Pam Becker, has been kindly coordinating this. We still need one or two individuals or families to host a pair of students this Saturday night. Get them back to church early on Sunday morning. Pam can give you the details, but would you please talk to Pam after worship or give her a call first thing later today or tomorrow morning so we can wrap up having rooms for all of the students who will be coming to share their musical gifts with us on Saturday night. Friends, please read all the rest of the announcements. I just want to say a couple others. If you have not made a pledge towards our 2024 budget, there are cards in the pews there. We welcome you to do that. This is not, I think, entirely surprising in light of our capital funds campaign, but we are probably more than $80,000, I've been told, behind where our pledges were at for this year. So we'd welcome your pledges, especially if you made a pledge last year and haven't had the time to do that yet this year. We would welcome your pledge as we try to figure out our income projections for next year to make decisions on our ministry budget. Now, on some different news financially for all of you, some of you have heard this, but especially want to share this with our DS. Our capital funds campaign has just been an amazingly overwhelming success. Through November the 9th, we had received gifts of over $191,000 that has been donated cash in hand. And then on top of that, we've received pledges that are yet to be collected, but to be given over the next 3 years of nearly $163,000. So when you add those two numbers together, that gives a total of cash in hand and pledges come up to over $354,000. For a campaign whose top goal was $300,000. So I think you should give yourself a round of applause out there. Because I'm going to do one thing real quick, because I can't remember if I've said this. I'm going to ask our district superintendent to just stand up briefly. I'd like to recognize Reverend Bruce Baxter, who's with us this morning. Bruce, good to worship with you today, and I am going to sit down and turn it over to our wonderful choir.
Come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us come before God's presence with thanksgiving.
Sing.
For the Lord is a great God and a great ruler above all gods.
In God's hand are the caverns of the earth and the heights of the hills as well.
The sea is God's, for God made it.
And God's hands have molded the dry land.
For that beautiful introit. I'm Kay Campbell and serving as your liturgist this morning. It's such a blessing to worship with you today, both here and online. So now, if you will please, let's stand as we are able and join in our call to worship. And remain standing, please, for our opening hymn. Our God has welcomed us into this place of worship. We will respond with praise and thanksgiving. Come one and all to give praise and glory to our God. As creation proclaims the greatness of God, so we proclaim God with word and song today. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Pam Becker, the music director here and your hymn leader. Old hymn, one of my favorites. I hope it is yours. Great is thy faithfulness. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. He is a great God. Let's sing with joy all three verses, hymn 140. Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you. remain standing for the affirmation of faith.
You will find our affirmation of faith on page 883, a statement of faith of the United Church of Canada. Let us say this together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and to make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope. In life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Friends, before I pray one prayer concern or name not in your bulletin, Joanne Stout, one of our members, passed away late in this past week, and persons are, need to share with you, share that her graveside service will be graveside service only tomorrow, Monday at 11 a.m. at our city cemetery, Poplar Bluff City Cemetery. There'll be visitation at the graveside from 10:30 to 11, and then graveside service tomorrow, 11 a.m. at the city cemetery for Joanne Stout. We'd ask you to remember John and the rest of her family in your prayers this day. And with that, I would invite you to pray with me, and let's go to God in prayer. Lord, we give you thanks for your love and grace in our lives, shared with us in so many ways. And Lord, I pray you would speak to us anew about your work in our lives and how we might see that as we look back and consider our life through its many years and its ups and downs. Oh Lord, as we come before you this day, we as always take time to remember others in need. We lift up persons on our prayer list this morning. We lift all of them to you, as well as we lift up persons in our military church family members who we also remember and give thanks for their service this day. But Lord, as we pray for others in need, we pray for their healing and wholeness, whether that be in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for it lies as appropriate for physical healing for some. We pray for greater mental health and emotional well-being for others. And we pray still for others for spiritual health and well-being, either a new relationship or a renewed relationship with you, O Lord. And at the same time, as we lift up so many individuals near and dear to us, O God, we also pray for your world. We lift up every nation on the face of the earth, including our own. We lift up many peoples and places in the midst of brokenness and suffering. And therefore, we pray for your church. We pray for sisters and brothers in Christ, from those in our congregation to those across our community, our country and your world. Strengthen us in shared service and witness and advocacy that your kingdom would come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And at the same time, O God, as we lift up many needs, many concerns, we also lift up to you within our hearts so many blessings and joys for the gift of life itself and the gift of your creation, for family and friends, for our community and nation, and for your greatest gift, our Lord Jesus Christ. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name, and we pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I would invite our ushers to come forward at this time as we continue to share in the giving and receiving of our tithes and offerings.
What?
bless these gifts and the givers of these gifts, that they all might be used for the work of your church and the coming of your kingdom in its fullness and glory. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 15, when Joseph makes himself known to his brothers in Egypt. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all his attendants, and he cried out, "Have everyone leave my presence." So there was no one with Joseph when he made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard him, and Pharaoh's household heard about it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still living?" But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come close to me." When they had done so, he said, "I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there has been famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will not be plowing and reaping. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So then it was not you who sent me here, but God. He made me a father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household, and ruler of all Egypt. Now hurry back to my father and say this to him. This is what your son Joseph says: God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, don't delay. You shall live in the region of Goshen and be near me, you, your children and grandchildren, your flocks and herds and all you have. I will provide for you there, because 5 years of famine are still to come. Otherwise, you and your household and all who belong to you will become destitute. You can see for yourselves, and so can my brother Benjamin, that it is really I who am speaking to you. Tell my father about all the honor accorded me in Egypt and about everything you have seen, and bring my father down here quickly." Then he threw his arms around his brother Benjamin and wept, and Benjamin embraced him weeping, and he kissed all his brothers and wept over them. Afterward, his brothers talked with him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Friends, before I preach, just a brief word of appreciation and giving credit where credit is due. The first form of the message that I've made my own this day, I heard from a professor at Iowa Wesley University called Dr. George Lemoore. He shared a message at National Methodist Men's Congress at Purdue way back in 81 when I was in college. I went there with my dad, and I've adapted his, I think, brilliant thoughts into a sermon that I pray will speak to you as it has to others before. And with that, would you bow with me and pray with me before the message? Lord, speak through me. When need be, speak in spite of me. Speak in spite of the sin and contradictions in my life. But above all, O God, speak beyond me. Speak beyond my words and the words and wisdom of others to your word, your living word for us in Jesus Christ, your word of life, your word of hope, your word of love. And speak to us, O God, today this strange message about hindsight. Give us the gift of spiritual hindsight like Joseph had, I pray. that we might proclaim your good work like him to our sisters and brothers and to our world. I ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a professor who had to take an airplane trip, so where he was flying, and he was running late in the airport. You may have had that experience. He was like almost running to get on the plane. They're about ready to close the doors. And so he ran down the aisle, hopped into a seat, and just plumped down without realizing he sat down on a newspaper that was in the seat underneath him. A woman across the aisle wanted to read it. There wasn't one on her side of the aisle of the plane. She was very polite, just like all of you try to be. So she asked a very gentle but kind of odd question. She said, "Sir, are you reading that?" And he looked her in the eye and with a straight face said, "Yes." And then about 10 minutes later, he stood up, he flipped the newspaper over, put it back in the seat, sat down back on it, and then sat there for another 10, 15 minutes. Then again, he got up, flipped the newspaper page over, sat it back in his seat, sat back down, did that for the whole rest of the flight. The woman, of course, eyes wide in astonishment as this went on. When they both got ready to get off the plane, he handed the paper to her and said, "Ma'am, you see, I just happen to have great hindsight." Good job. Even that's, although it's a groaner, it's a good one, friends, there, I think. And besides, it introduces the topic I want to talk about today. Hindsight, as I look backwards to the choir. Hindsight has a bad reputation, does it not, in our country, in our world? What we seem to celebrate is foresight, or more probably accurately, we celebrate vision. But we're talking about forward vision, a positive vision, a vision of a preferred future more than where we are today. We celebrate that in the church, in business, even in politics. But what about hindsight? Does hindsight have any value for us? We mainly just make fun of people with good hindsight. And I would say to you, as followers of Jesus like myself, of course, what I really want to talk about is spiritual hindsight. Is there any value, any gift in looking back over our lives to try to discern the movement of God from the past and the present? I would suggest to you that one of the central parts of the story of Joseph in Genesis is spiritual hindsight. I think it's valuable for us today. I'm going to invite you to reflect on that with me today during this message. Before I talk about that more, let's recap the Joseph story. If you haven't read Genesis in a while, it's in Genesis 37 through chapter 50, through the end of the book of Genesis. Joseph was the second youngest son of Jacob, yet Joseph was Jacob's favorite child. And you know that can be kind of dangerous, friends. In fact, this did not endear his 11 brothers to Joseph, and you may remember if you've read that anytime recently. In fact, you may remember Joseph had a pair of dreams that one day all of his other 11 brothers would look up to him, and at the same time, they would literally bow down to him. He would be so raised up above them that they would bow down the way you might bow down to a king or a queen. For the rest of this recap, I'm deeply indebted to Dr. James Forbes, the great preacher from some years gone by, who used the metaphor that the rest of Joseph's life story was a whole series of ups and downs. Joseph stood up high in the esteem of his father. He was high up in his father's favor, and that made his brother say, "Let's put him down. Let's pull him down off of his high horse and put him in the ground." And that's what they did. As you may remember, says in Genesis 37, they put him in a pit, and that wasn't far down enough. Eventually, they sold him into slavery, and Joseph went down into Egypt. But there, even in Egypt, in slavery, he was made the head of a master's household, and he rose up in that master's esteem. He was doing well and held up high in respect by the master. And then the master's wife tried to say to Joseph, "You know, let's have an affair. Let's get together romantically." She tried to pull Joseph's morals down. I'll say this just for the DS here today. Some pastor suggested, Mrs. Potiphar said to Joseph, "Let's get down together, brother." But Joseph said, no. "I will hold my morals up high. I'm not going to have an affair with you. I'll hold my values up high." But of course, when Mrs. Potiphar made a false accusation against him to her husband. She had him arrested. And Joseph's life went down again as he went into prison in Egypt. But even in prison, the Lord was with him. And he began to rise up again in esteem of the head jailer there. He was the prisoner put in charge of the other prisoners because of his leadership ability. And then some of the prisoners started having dreams they couldn't make sense out of. He started interpreting their dreams. And they were so struck by that. The cupbearer of the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, was so struck by that. And Joseph said to him, "Cupbearer, when you get set free, when you go back to the king, to Pharaoh, just remember me." And the cupbearer got set free. But he forgot Joseph. He let him down. But then eventually the cupbearer remembered Joseph, and he told Pharaoh about his ability to interpret dreams. And Pharaoh called Joseph up out of prison to come to his court, and guided by the Spirit of God, Joseph interpreted Pharaoh's dreams for him in such a meaningful way that Pharaoh eventually made him second in command, only under Pharaoh, in all of Egypt, of overseeing the country. And so Joseph's dream seemed to be fulfilled. He had risen up so high in the world. Everything seemed to be going great. And then there was another dramatic twist and turn in the story. Famine hit Egypt, and famine also hit the land of Canaan, where his family was still living. Jacob's father sent some of his brothers down to Egypt to buy grain so they might stay alive. When they came, Joseph recognized all his brothers, but somehow his brothers didn't recognize him. He treated them harshly, as they would have expected an Egyptian leader to have taught them. He didn't want to give away at that time his family relationship to them. But he said to them, "Don't come back unless you bring your youngest brother Benjamin with you." Benjamin was who was closest to Joseph, the only full brother in his family tree. So the brothers go back home to Jacob. Life goes on. They live for a while, but then the famine continues. They run out of food again. So they go back down to Egypt, and they do as Joseph asked. They brought his only full brother, Benjamin, with them. Joseph is so elated, he doesn't say this out loud, of course. He's so elated, he says, "You've got to leave Benjamin with me. That's the rules I'm making." And his brothers say, no, we can't do that. If you keep Benjamin here, our father will die because of grief. He's already lost one son. He won't survive losing two. Joseph then shifts gears. He relents. And then we come to the scene, the dramatic scene, in our scripture reading for today that Kay read so well from Genesis 45, when Joseph reveals himself to his brothers. And when he does this, he shares with them a profound spiritual insight. He says, "I'm your brother Joseph, whom you sold into slavery. But now don't be angry with yourselves because you sold me here, because God sent me before you to preserve life." As it says later in Genesis 50, verse 18 or 19, that though Joseph's brothers acted to harm Joseph, God took those actions and used them for good. It says God took the evil actions of Joseph's brothers, selling him into slavery, and transformed that into good by raising up Joseph at a later time so that he could preserve the lives of many people, including his own family, including the covenant family of Jacob. But friends, what I really want you to note is this profound spiritual reflection only comes in hindsight to Joseph. I invite you to double check me on this. If you haven't read Genesis 37 to 50 recently, read that later today, this week, this month. You'll see that when Joseph is sold into slavery, Bible doesn't say it all. God doesn't say to him, "This is going to work out okay, Joseph. I'm working in this, just hang in there." It certainly doesn't say that the brothers meant any good to come out of this. At one point, the text says they wanted to kill Joseph, but they relent. They don't take his life, but sell him into slavery because they hated him because of his arrogant dreams. I think this idea of spiritual hindsight has a lot to say for itself when we know one other thing about Joseph. According to Genesis, God never spoke to him directly. He never made a direct covenant with God, as his great-grandfather Abraham did on more than one occasion. He never has a direct vision or dream from God like his father Jacob had of the spiritual experience of Jacob's ladders and the angels going up and down and descending into heaven. God obviously was at work in his life and work in his life in powerful ways. But according to my reading of Genesis, you go back and read it, see if you read it differently, there's never a direct personal encounter of Joseph with the living God. And yet, in hindsight, he could look back over his life and see the hand of God at work in a powerful way. Friends, that seems very relevant to me, because my guess is that might connect with some of you and some of your story. In my 35 plus years as a pastor, in every church I've served, there's been a few people that would tell me about an experience of where the Lord really spoke to them directly. Or they would tell an experience of having a vision of God beside them or with them in the midst of a crisis or a tough time. Or in some other way that God kind of directly revealed some of God's grace and goodness to them. But in every church I've served, those people have been in the minority. I've never been in a church where the majority of people said something like, "Well, John, yeah, just this past Tuesday, I was at my breakfast table, and Jesus was just sitting there right next to me. You know, and I talked to him for 15, 20 minutes, just like I'm talking to you now." I've had a few people talk like that, in a different way, probably, but never a majority of the people. And if that's the same case here, which I'm not sure about, but maybe, then you and Joseph may have a lot in common. I'd say probably maybe two key things. First of all, I bet a number of you, even though you're faithful people, have never had a direct experience of the living God, to use a fancy word, an epiphany, an appearance of God or an appearance of the Lord. And yet at the same time, I'm sure all of your lives are just like Joseph, that God is at work in your lives in powerful and meaningful ways, just like Joseph's life. You might say, "Well, how do I know that?" One thing that'll help you is spiritual hindsight. So I would commend that to all of you. If you haven't done this recently, when you've got some time, either later today or this week or later this month, take some time and look back over your own personal journey. Look over your life journey, your own ups and downs, and ups and downs. And see what you can see with the help of the Spirit about how God has worked at your life. And especially in those down times when you were in the pit, just like Joseph, how God raised you up somehow. You might be surprised with hindsight what we can see about the work of God in our lives, just like Joseph did. Now, friends, I would never suggest you to do this if I hadn't done it myself and find it helpful. So if you're wondering, you might say, "Preacher, that all sounds good in a sermon, but what the heck would that look like in my personal life?" Let me tell you a bit of a story. One of the most amazing experiences in my entire life of 62 plus years was to meet my biological mother back in 2005. And to begin a relationship with her that I am blessed to have to this day. She told me some of the story behind my adoption that was rather striking to me. So real quick bit of background, I might have said this in a sermon before, I'm not sure. My mother Lillian, that adopted me and raised me, never told me I was adopted until the day she died. She never said a word to me that I was adopted. And my father, remember, it was a totally different time, not like today where that's a common thing, was 1961. My father only talked to me about it briefly one or two times in my entire life after I brought it up to them that I knew, and they obviously knew, that I was adopted. But my mother, my biological mother, told me some of the story behind my adoption. Here it is in a nutshell. I'm not sure whether you use the word girl or young woman, but my birth mom was 18 years old when she gave birth to me. And she was already an orphan. Both of her parents were dead by the time I was conceived, let alone born. She was being raised by her stepfather, who had, again, an entirely different time and era and probably made some good sense, maybe would today as well back then, said to her, you know, pardon my colloquialism, honey, you're not going to raise this baby. You can't raise this baby. This baby's going to be put up for adoption. And so for a good while, though, it wasn't clear who was going to care for me, who was going to bring me up. With hindsight, I've come to realize probably the most vulnerable time in my life of a little over 62 years was in the 2, 3, 4 months before I was born. Because it was literally an open question for months of that time, who was going to take care of this baby, who was going to be helpless when the baby was born. Then my birth mother told me what I would call the mind-bending story that my biological aunt and uncle almost adopted me at the last minute before my parents did. She had desperately asked some of her aunts and uncles, family members, you know, would you take this baby and raise it as your own? And they initially all said, no, Barbara, I'm sorry, that's just not going to work. We can't do that. Then at the last minute, like maybe 2 weeks, 10 days before I was supposed to go to Jim and Lillian in a private adoption, they said, okay, no, I think we can do it. Now, let me tell you some of what that would have meant. If that would have happened, the name I would still have today be the name I was given at birth, Keith Stack. I'm so glad Keith Berry's here today, because I want to tell him I like him and I like that name, but I have a hard time picturing myself as Keith. And let me give you a little more background. If I would have stayed Keith Stack, I would have been Keith Stack who grew up in Michigan, raised by Roman Catholic parents, rather than John Gregory, who grew up in St. Louis County, going to a Methodist and United Methodist church just like this one. I say the story's mind-bending because on more than one occasion, I've sat back in my home, my house, a parsonage provided by other people like you, and thought to myself, who would Keith Stack from Michigan be? Who would he be like? Two things seem abundantly clear to me. First of all, undoubtedly, he would be a very different person than John Gregory from St. Louis. And beyond that, I'll say this, and I hope in our DS will especially appreciate this. I'm 99-point-something% sure that Keith Stack, who grew up in Michigan with Roman Catholic parents, would not be standing as your pastor in the pulpit of First United Methodist Church in Poplar Bluff today. But when I look back, I see the amazing grace of God in my adoption, that a couple named Jim and Lillian Gregory that desperately wanted to have children but couldn't have them biologically. This is a true story. My mom told me one day she wanted to have a whole baseball team full of kids. She wished she could have had 7, 8, 9 kids, but that was not the gift of God in her journey. But they adopted me, brought me into their home, raised me up, gave me their name, and most importantly, they took me to church where they were charter members, founding members at Concord Trinity UMC down in South County, where, of all things, your former pastor serves there today. Friends, I didn't know that story till after I was 40 years old. That's what I'm talking about, the power of hindsight. I not only didn't know it at the time, I didn't know it when I was 25, 35, 40. But with spiritual hindsight, I give thanks to God today for who I am. John Gregory from St. Louis, Missouri. Because I literally could have been someone with another name, from another state, from another church background. So I give thanks to God for Jim and Lillian Gregory who adopted me, for my biological mother, Barbara, who through tremendous challenges gave birth to me, and others who had helped to adopt me, who worked in that process, and I've only seen all of that in hindsight. So friends, I invite you to take some time this day, this week, this month, and look back over your life, its own ups and downs, and see where you might see the hand of God as I've seen it in my past with spiritual hindsight. Friends, I'm going to say one more thing and then we've got to wrap up and close this service. If you do that, or maybe you've done that recently, maybe you've got a story in your mind right now about some of the work of God in your life, tell somebody that story. Share with someone else the story of the work of God, the hand of God at work in your life. Now, friends, don't get me wrong. I hope the DS won't get in trouble for saying this. I'm not suggesting you go out to some stranger, you know, at Walmart, or stop somebody in the produce aisle at Kroger and just say, hey, let me tell you this story. You know, they don't know who you are. I'd appreciate that. I'm not trying to say that you shouldn't share it maybe with an unchurched person, maybe someday. But first of all, I'd say share it with your family. Depending on your age, tell the story of what God's done in your life. Depending on your age, to your kids, or to maybe your grandkids, or if you're a different age, if your parents are still alive, maybe to your parents, if you're married, to your spouse. And maybe you could take that a different step if you've got a trusted friend at work, a trusted coworker, a trusted friend in your neighborhood, a friend in your church, especially maybe a friend in your Sunday school class or small group. Tell them some of your experience of the hand of God at work in your life. How God has lifted you up out of the depths, just like God did for Joseph. Friends, spiritual hindsight's a good thing. For with it, Joseph was able to proclaim to his brothers and eventually through Scripture to the world about what God had done for him that he didn't realize at the time. But with hindsight, he realized how God took the evil actions of his brothers and transformed them to the good to preserve life, to preserve his covenant family. And I'd say, may God give us the gift of the same spiritual hindsight, that we might know some of our own story about what God has done for us so that we could share it with others to a world that desperately needs the good news of God and the good news of Jesus Christ. I invite you to share the story of God's work in your life through spiritual hindsight with others. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Thank you, Pastor John. That was a beautiful sermon. I would venture to say that most of us have been in a pit like Joseph. And if you've only been there once, consider yourself blessed, because some of us have been in the pit, whether by others pushing you down or by poor decisions you've made. If you've lived to be as long as some of us, you've fallen in a pit or been put in a pit. But as a believer in Jesus Christ, he doesn't want you to stay there. All you have to do is profess your faith, lift your hand, and he will lift you up out of that pit, because his ways are higher than ours. Whether we understand why we're in the pit or not, his ways are higher than ours. He will always, always take care of you. And that is the title of our final hymn this morning, God Will Take Care of You. So please stand, and hymns here, 130. And it's God Will Take Care of You. We will do verses 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you.
Friends, go forth in peace, and may God give us the gift of spiritual hindsight. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.